Good morning and welcome to you, the listening and viewing public, to the media, as well as to our panelists. Again, if you happen to send us a question this morning and it's not answered, the answers will go on gov.ky under the FAQ section for you. Also, if you're a civil servant and you have any questions to ask in regards to any HR related matters, you can send emails to hrconnect@gov.ky. We're now going to begin the press conference. I'd like to also introduce our sign language interpreter, Ms. Carolyn Powell, before we begin. We'll start this morning with Dr. Lee.
Good morning. Yesterday we announced two further positive cases at Health City Cayman Islands. Today I'd like to announce a positive result for a patient at the Health Services Authority. Every precaution has been taken related to the this particular patient. Staff who've been involved in the care of this patient have been isolated at home along with their close contacts, and the patient has been in isolation for some time now. There is a rider to this. As you know, our results are preliminary as we're still waiting some confirmations from CAFA, and all our positive results are being sent to CAFA for further investigation. As a rider to this particular result, it is undergoing further investigation at CAFA because there are some issues around the scientific details of the test, which mean that we really need to make absolutely sure that it's positive. But it was reported as positive from our laboratory. In addition to that information, there were 14 negatives that I did not announce yesterday that I'm announcing now. I want to just take this opportunity to remind people that they have a duty under the public health law to advise the public health department of anybody that may be suspected or is suffering from COVID. So that includes both medical practitioners and the heads of any family unit.
Okay. Premier McLaughlin.
Donna. Maybe we should take questions now relating to what.
Okay. All right. Questions from the media?
Thank you. Good morning. Reshma Raghunath, Cayman Compass. Dr. Lee, first of all, walk us through the situation with this patient at HSA and the steps that are being taken. Also, how many people are now in isolation as a result of this?
If I may, I think that would be better handled by the Health Service Authority themselves. We have Ms. Lizette here, the Chief Executive, and Dr. Sam Williams here as well.
Okay.
Good morning, everyone. As you know, the HSA has been preparing for quite some months now for the COVID virus. So when we got this result, we quickly moved into a response phase. So all persons who were direct contacts with the patient has been placed in isolation with their families. And that number is 14 patients who were in direct contact with the patient. Staff members who were in contact with the patient.
Okay, so 14 staff members, how many family members? Or is that in total how many people are now in isolation as a result of this?
You want to speak with them?
Thanks for the question. We are in the family member, we have a close family contact that have been in isolation as well, and he has been tested, he's been tested, and also we have another 8 household member that have been in isolation, and we are sending a team today to the house to complete the investigation, also to do testing for them. That team will be led by the most senior public health nurse at the HSA, another public health nurse, and 2 other staff. They will be going to the house this morning to also to do contact tracing. I need to add as well that we have been in communication with the Customs and Border Control just to ascertain the travel history for the patient itself, the close contact, and all the other house members. And we have received some communication already from Customs and Border Control regarding that.
And what can you share with us regarding the travel history? What further information can you provide?
The information that we have received so far none of the, neither the patient or the closer contact have any recent travel history. We are still ascertaining information from the rest of the household.
So is this classified now as our first community transmission of COVID-19?
I think, as Dr. Lee has mentioned before, this is still a preliminary result, and we're going through communication with the Caribbean Public Health Agency to confirm this result. But so far, the result that we haven't linked this patient, this particular patient, with anyone with a travel history. But we're still investigating, like I said, the investigation. We're sending a team to the house this morning to collect more information on that.
Now, apart from the direct contact, can you advise for patients who would have visited this ward, if this patient was on a ward, of course, or the clinic that this patient would have been in, what kind of advice would you give to members of the public in light of this development today?
No other patients have had direct contact with this particular patient. However, all the patients that were on the ward during these days, they have been advised, and they will be receiving also a letter with instruction, but they have been advised already that in case they present with any respiratory symptom in the next 14 days, they need to call the public health department. But none of them are close contact with this patient at all.
So these patients, as well as their family members, are also now in isolation?
These patients don't need to be in isolation because they're not primary contact. They're secondary contact of this patient, and they don't need to be in isolation. They were not exposed.
Okay. Just to go back to Dr. Lee, if possible, and the preliminary testing. Now, you said you needed to get confirmation on the positives. Why are we not sending the negatives to be accurate that the results are, in fact, negative?
So what we did when we started the testing, we sent all of the tests we did in the first batch to CAFA. That actually was a lot of negative results. But as CAFA is our reference laboratory, so although we do the tests here, we still get these sorts of results backed up by CAFA. All of the positives will be sent, and we've agreed that we'd send 1 in 10 the negatives for checking. But certainly the first batch that I sent, they're all still remaining preliminary because that first batch, which were all negative, was sent to CAFA for cross-checking. I am very pleased to say that they have finally arrived at CAFA and they are being run on their system as we speak.
So what's the timeline to get those tests, the confirmation from the test?
I thought this afternoon.
By this afternoon?
I would have imagined so. I would have thought so. But I can't be absolutely sure. I don't know their systems, but I would have thought that sort of timeline.
Okay, so in... also back to the positive case from yesterday, because we didn't get a chance to expand on that because you didn't have the information on hand. Can you tell us more information on these two positive cases in terms of who they are or their categorization category?
Health City have now been able to let me know that one of them was a member of staff and one of them was a patient on the same ward as the now deceased first case.
So what additional steps have been taken in light of these positive results?
All of the patients that are there had been isolated from the time that we first knew about the case, so that's not changed. And all of the staff that were involved were all put through their 14-day quarantine period or longer if they had symptoms. Some of them still have symptoms, so they're still under their self-isolation.
And in the family members or visitors who would have attended the hospital to visit this positive case, has any additional steps been taken in relation
They've
to
taken
them?
The necessary steps with regard to that, yes.
I'll give way for someone else. If anyone else.
Kevin?
Good morning. Kevin Morales, Cayman Compass. Dr. Lee, just to follow up on that, correct me if I'm wrong, and I might be... We were under the impression that all of the tests from the staff at Health City came back negative. So, other than the two that we initially talked about.
Yes. So they've been sending more and more tests as time's gone on. The original batch came back as negative, but that's not the only batch that they had. Some others have been sent subsequently. So we still actually, today, still have some outstanding which we've not run through the system. From more people who've had some symptoms. So people have developed symptoms. Although we had the initial lot that developed symptoms, some people have developed symptoms over time, and all of those people have been isolated at the moment they've had symptoms.
Okay, so this wasn't the case of a false negative
No.
Oh, okay.
No. It was just only come to light now.
Yeah. And in the circumstance of the patient at Health City, again, we've been told this entire time that the gentleman who arrived from the cruise ship was in isolation, and after the staff there started showing symptoms, they too were put in isolation. So all that being said, how could another patient on the same ward possibly have, I guess, caught it?
I think it's really because that story is not 100% correct, what you've just recounted to me. So he was put in isolation when they first had a suspicion that there was any suggestion he had a respiratory condition. When he first arrived, he was not on isolation because it was purely a cardiac
right.
case, and there was no suggestion. So that's the time at which they would have been may have been exposed.
Thank you. And turning our attention to the patient at the Health Services Authority, are you able to say how long this patient has been there?
I think that's really a question for Health Service Authority, but a relatively short period of time. And I need to advise you that, in fact, the patient was not symptomatic for anything. The reason that the test was done is there was some consideration about whether this patient would need to be transferred to the United States for extra treatment. And on the basis of that, the test was done because the U.S. won't accept anybody without a COVID test. There was the patient is entirely well from the respiratory point of view.
And the reason I asked about the timing was I was just curious if he had been there since the Cayman Islands Hospital went on lockdown. If the patient would have come afterward, after the visitor restrictions were placed.
I think the Cayman Islands Hospital is not on lockdown. It's just not accepting routine cases. So anything that's emergent or needs management will be accepted. So they're still accepting patients.
And visitors, I mean, I guess that's more what I'm speaking to.
I can't answer that question. Sorry. I don't know about the visitors. I don't know if Ms. Yearwood would be able to answer that.
I'll just clarify my question, Ms. Yearwood, but if you can answer, it'd be great. Since, I guess, the restrictions have been put on visitors, did this patient arrive there after that or before?
Thank you for that question. The patient actually arrived after we had the visitor restriction.
Okay, thank you.
Any further questions from anyone in the room? No? Okay. I do have some questions from the public for you, Dr. Lee. Persons are asking questions like, are we going to get any idea as to where this person, the district where they may be living, that sort of stuff, because obviously people are worried at this point.
That's not the sort of information that public health would normally release until such time as we had some sort of wider distribution, not for an individual person, though.
Okay. All the other questions I have related are to Premier and the Governor. Premier McLaughlin?
Yes, thank you. Hello, everyone. So in response to the information that we received yesterday afternoon from the chief medical officer, the government has made some decisions, notwithstanding the fact that there are questions around whether or not this is a true positive. We have decided to move to the next phase. We don't think we can be too cautious in the circumstances. So the first decision we have taken is to increase the curfew hours from 7 p.m. tonight until 6 a.m. in the morning for the period of the next 10 days. Secondly, from 6 a.m. tomorrow morning, all non-essential establishments will be closed. Persons will be required to shelter in place, which translates to meaning stay at home, unless you fall into one of the categories of essential workers, or unless your establishment, your business qualifies as an essential establishment. Now, all of this is happening very, very quickly. Cabinet has not yet had a chance to meet since this revelation. We have worked overnight to put to draft the necessary regulations to give this the force of law, and Cabinet will convene at 12. We hope to have all of this done and dusted over the course of this afternoon, and we will hold another press conference later in the afternoon to announce the detail relating to these matters. And that is important because persons need to have some degree of certainty as to whether or not they or how they are impacted by the curfew and by the requirement to close all non-essential establishments and for persons who are not essential workers to remain at home, so that we can outline the exceptions to that, because obviously we cannot reasonably insist that people don't go out to get food, to get fuel, to get money, to see the doctor. So those sort of exceptions have to be clearly set out in the regulations, and when they have been approved, I'll be able to speak with greater specificity to those. This is essentially a lockdown, but we believe that this is the best chance this country has of suppressing the community transmission of the virus, and we are taking the step now rather than waiting until there are multiple cases around, by which time, from what we see in other countries, it is usually much too late.
Dr. Lee, I do have a question from CNS.
Can I just say, are we going into questions?
Please, Governor.
I think there's a few more comments. I mean, Mr. Seymour probably wants to say a word. I mean, first of all, just to say I strongly support everything that the Premier has just said. I mean, despite that there is a doubt, but there is a positive case, an abundance of caution is absolutely right. And we have been saying for a long period now that it was inevitable that there would be this occurrence. And so we have no option but to tighten significantly the measures that government has already taken. And the main message, as the Premier said, is that if you're not an essential worker or have essential business, which will be set out in detail later, stay at home. That means don't visit friends. It means don't visit family members who are not in your household. It means we are trying to limit to the maximum extent possible any human contact so that we can suppress any cases that might be out there, isolate them, trace them, and really lock those down. I think this is so important for our elderly people, so please, a message to our elderly people to be extra careful and listening carefully to all the messaging around. And I do want to say a word about the police. The police are working extremely hard to get ready for the curfew. We've had numerous meetings with the police commissioner. And when we move to this curfew, it's not going to be perfect from day one. It's impossible to devise a system which will be perfect. So we will need people to have common sense and be pragmatic, and we will improve it and enhance it as we go along. But the key thing is it will remove many thousands of people from our roads and our streets and limit those human contacts. And the police, I would ask everyone to cooperate with the police. They have a job to do, and we need everybody to be constructive, and let's really work with the police as they implement this. We will be able to call on Customs and Border Control, because the border's been closed. They have some staff who will be able to help the police. We have the 40 special constables to be able to call on them. We also have a state-of-the-art helicopter, which is going to be extremely important up in the skies, monitoring how this curfew is being observed. And that has incredibly powerful equipment on it and will be a real asset at this particular time. We're going to do this for 10 days, and we want to see where we are at that point, and if we can absolutely suppress this, we may be able to consider relaxing some of these measures. So this is the time for everybody to come together and support these measures. And so I want to thank everyone who's doing so much to get us in the best possible place. Our law enforcement, emergency services, health professionals, our health workers, people in supermarkets, and essential services. Everybody, I thank you all for what you are doing. Very last point from me. Yesterday I mentioned that we are setting up an emergency travel line for people who might have emergency travel needs. The number for that travel line is 244-3333. Now, this is only for people who have emergency or compassionate reasons to travel. And I've mentioned that we're looking at setting up an air bridge between the UK and the overseas territories, and that would be how we would arrange for emergency travel. And those discussions are progressing. But this is only for emergencies. But do phone that number if you have an emergency situation for any reason whatsoever. Thank you.
Mr. Seymour.
Good morning to the people of Cayman Islands, Cayman Brac and Little Cayman. We are possibly at the point that everyone in the world has feared and has proved to be the most fatal for most communities and countries, the community spreading. Where community spreading is occurring are in the accelerated phase. The duration and severity of each phase can vary depending on the characteristics of the virus and our response. We are trying to stay ahead of this disease by acting as early as we can. We are all in this together. Now, we want you to follow all the measures that have been put in place, all the instructions that we set out, whether you're just going to the supermarket or to the pharmacy. We can get some good results on the other end of this monster if the measures are followed. This is not the time to second guess or criticize the actions or spread false rumors. We are taking this, it is a time of unity and common sense, not to make the same mistakes as other countries and communities has made. This is a time for you to keep everyone in check, even if you have to say, please keep your 6 feet distance for your own safety. Studies around the world suggest that it's also airborne, so please do all possible to stay home in your quarters. If you have a cramped living situation where multiple persons are living in a room, please call the hotline and ride this out at one of our isolated locations, as the life you save may be your own or your grandmother's or your grandfather's. Please hear the urgency in our voice. Hear our plea to be a shining example to the region and to the world for that matter. Washing your hands and distance is the proven way to avoid this disease. We have had 10 press conferences now, and now we hope that every household has their own plan if someone gets sick in the home. If you're not sure, please call the hotline. I am told additional ventilators have arrived. I'm told we have hundreds of thousands of masks and more on the way. We will order and give support in whatever way we have to save every person in the Cayman Islands. The Cayman Islands' goal is to minimize serious illness and overall death and to minimize societal disruption. I thank you and God bless.
Thank you, Minister Seymour. A question for Dr. Lee from Cayman Youth Service, saying, Dr. Lee, you talked about the asymptomatic patient who's now positive. Are you not worried that the criteria being followed to test is leaving us terribly exposed?
We are following the guidelines that have been given out by the multiple public health agencies on the matter. I think in this particular instance, that's exactly the sort of thing that we wish to understand better as to why somebody would have a positive test through our laboratory. Learning more about that from CAFA would be very helpful. It remains the case that people may be viremic before they show any symptoms. And indeed, the symptoms may be especially mild. And we've already discussed the case that in children, we think they may be able to carry it, even though most of them sail through without too much distress and sickness. But it also remains the case that if you're not actually expressing symptoms, then it's more difficult for you to transmit the virus from one person to another because you're not coughing and sneezing. And that's the key element as to why we've been given the advice that somebody who is asymptomatic is unlikely to transmit it. We are, as I've said previously in a statement recently released, we're learning more about this all the time. So in order to protect all of us, that's why the government has been putting in all of these measures to try and keep the distance, because we do know that distance is going to protect you and that washing your hands and staying away from people with respiratory symptoms is going to protect you. And so whilst we find out more, just do that, and that'll probably stand us all in very good stead.
Premier McLaughlin, a question for you, sir. Being that regulations have to be put in place, persons are wondering how quickly those regulations will be put in place, because obviously everybody is now messaging and asking who are essential services, who are non-essential. Their courier companies have goods coming in that may need security staff. So how quickly do you see those regulations being put in place that a list can be given to the public as to who's non-essential and who's essential?
That's why we're calling the press conference this afternoon.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Any other questions from the media? Ralph?
Good morning. Ralph Lewis, Caymanian Times. Actually, the question I had was for the Premier regarding logistics. We are in a lockdown. We understand that we will be getting information on those essential services. However, just want to get a sense of how our lives will be disrupted. And also, can you give some confidence to the some comfort to the listeners regarding transportation? Are the ports going to be locked down? Are the ports going to remain available for goods to come in? And also the fuel. Is the fuel ships will be able to still come to the island during the 10 days?
There is no planned restriction of cargo vessels, courier planes, cargo planes, the fuel tankers, any of those coming to Cayman. There will be restrictions on what the crew can do and on their landing, but not on the continuation of the services.
Thank you.
Thank you. This is for Premier. So in light of the new changes for the curfew, how will this impact businesses like supermarkets? I know they've changed their hours. Now they're opening. Now the curfew is kicking in earlier. And also, would this be something the Cabinet may consider, waiving Sunday trade to allow for less congregation of people on Saturday and during the week so that we can spread out the number of people that are going to the supermarket?
Well, supermarkets are obviously an essential service. I mean, I think any of the businesses you think of as generally essential services will be on the list. Those are the easy ones. There are many that we never quite contemplate as being essential services or essential workers, but are. Sanitation workers, waste collect, all of those things. So the list that we put together is not going to be perfect, but we will make a provision. We've looked at what's been done in some of the other countries. We will make a provision which allows a competent authority, and we have to decide who that authority should be, the ability to declare a particular establishment as essential or category of workers as essential. I mean, some things that, some carve-outs that you might not even think of. I'm a farmer, but this never occurred to me until a farmer called me this morning and said, I hear you're all going to put the country in lockdown. So if you keep my workers from going to my farm, all of my animals are going to starve to death. So who would have thought that, you know, that a farm worker would be an essential worker? But in that context, you understand that you can't lock them down because animals need to be fed, things need to be done. So we're going to put in a provision which allows a competent authority, because they're bound to be instances that none of us think of immediately, but someone will give a call and say, but you can't lock this down. So that's why we're spending, rather than rushing to make the full announcement this morning, we just, despite our best efforts, and I'm eternally grateful to the AG and his staff and the Solicitor General and her staff for the incredible work they are doing, trying to keep up to date with what we're doing. So we're hoping we get this done this afternoon. Cabinet can approve it, and we can then publish the list. But as I say, I ask people to bear with us, be patient. If there's an issue, nobody has any trouble getting me, believe you me, or anybody, any of the other elected members. Let us know, and to the extent it is possible, we will seek to make the necessary adjustments to have the country function as best it can in what are going to be very, very restrictive circumstances. But we are saying we're not asking them now, this is going to have the force of law. Unless your establishment is absolutely essential, you need to shut it down, and you need to send your people home.
The Sunday sales aspect, would that be under consideration?
Yes, that is a consideration I think that we would want to have, but we would want to speak with their supermarkets in particular themselves, because they have got to gear up to deal with these things. And we'll see what they say.
Okay. This is for Dr. Lee. Just to go back to the patient at HSA, you said that the test was conducted so that he could be sent, the patient, I don't know if it's he or she, to be sent away for additional medical treatment. Can you provide us with an update on the patient's condition and what's happening with the patient in light of the COVID-19 positive?
I think it's fair to say that was no longer that's no longer a requirement. But more than that, I think I'll leave it at that. But the requirement is now no longer there.
And the condition of the two positives from yesterday as well, can you provide us with?
I have had a brief report. No problems. Yeah. Yes. So they're well. Yeah. They're not. They don't seem to have developed any serious symptoms. And in addition, the two people who had previously been admitted and they were not sure what it was, those people have also been. Everybody at Health City is getting better.
Okay. Just for clarification on the testing, the point that you made on testing earlier when it comes to the HSA patient and the family members, did you say 8 people are being tested or how many people are being tested and are these tests warranted at this time?
I think that was Dr. Williams. So there's two different groups. Mm-hmm. There's the group of contacts, the staff members who looked after, who had somehow been involved in the care of this person. And then there's the group of people who... are contacts in the community. So those were the two groups that you'd heard Ms. Lizette mention, 14, and then I think Dr. Williams mentioned 8. So they're two separate groups.
And they're all being tested?
The staff have all been tested and sent home to be isolated. And as Dr. Williams mentioned, the community people are being contacted as we speak.
Okay. So in light of these findings today, I know the pharmacy is still operating at HSA, and accident and emergency. Are additional protocols going to be put in place in light of what we know, the result that we now have?
Uh,
Thank you, Reshma. Yes, we will be announcing those closures later on, the restrictions that we will have in place for the pharmacy.
Thank you, Ms. Yearwood. Now, in light of that, for people who would have gone to the pharmacy or had access to the services in the interim while before we had this, what should they do, or should they do anything at all at this point?
We will let the patients know when we will be able to provide medication.
Thank you.
Premier McLaughlin, question for you. Can you answer any questions as it relates to banks, construction companies, and restaurants? Will they have to close? Will they be closing?
Well, we're still debating this issue about banking services, so we haven't come to a final view about that. Looking at what's been done in some other places, we've had discussions overnight with the banks, and again this morning, we haven't come to a final decision about the banks. But people do need to have access to banking services. The question is how we do that and what periods it should be available and so forth. But we'll sort that over, you know, over the course of the next few hours. Construction companies, all should shut down, all of them. Restaurants, the delivery service and the takeout services need to remain. Many people in this country rely on restaurants to feed themselves. So we're also looking at, because the curfew is now so early at 7 o'clock, the people who are providing those services and doing the deliveries and so forth would have to be categorized as essential workers so that they can operate within the curfew up to a limited point. So we're still debating whether that should be at, say, 9 o'clock or 10 o'clock, as the case may be,
okay,
so that people can get their dinner. So all of those little issues are why I can't make a final announcement. We're still contemplating all of these things.
Okay. And you mentioned food. So, Dr. Lee, someone was asking if you could speak about the importance of person's diet at this point as it relates to the virus and how it may help them to fend it off.
You picked one of my favorite topics. So, yeah, I mean, diet's always, no matter what your medical condition is, diet's important. Mm-hmm. If certainly for those who are less physically active, a long period of inactivity relative, you know, when it becomes more than a week, you need to start thinking about maybe cutting back what you're eating a little bit. But eating healthier things, fresh food, if you can possibly get hold of it, is always a good idea. But even if you're restricted to your own home environment, you can still exercise, and I would recommend people even take it up if you weren't doing it before. We've heard all the stories of people running marathons in their apartments in China. So you can do, even in small confines, you can be inventive and do stuff. And if you've got a family, it will also entertain all of the family to do some of these things together.
Okay. But not outside. Not outside.
the details of this are yet to be ironed out and will be announced a bit later today.
Okay. Ralph.
Yes. Two final questions. Dr. Lee, you mentioned that there's going to be a website with statistics on the developments of the cases. Is that live yet?
Yes, sir. So if you click on gov.ky/coronavirus, there's a little button. I'm sorry, it's not a ticker tape, but click the button and it'll pop up.
Okay, very good. And my final question for the governor, I know you're concerned regarding fake news, especially now as we move into a serious phase. We're still seeing snippets of fake news permeating the websites, and it's causing confusion. Can you just remind us how serious it is and what steps you'll be taking to deal with those?
Yes, no, of course. Thank you. I mean, we have repeatedly underlined that there's no excuse for fake news. And in fact, I saw one myself this morning about some of these cases. And just to say again that where we have evidence that the police have the powers to do something about this, and we will do everything we can within the law to take action against people who deliberately put around fake news, which just causes alarm and concern. So I just again urge everybody to think twice before they circulate any information like this, particularly in the context of what we're dealing with at the moment.
Thank you.
There is one question that relates to civil servants. Maybe the deputy governor can answer this question. They're asking whether what will happen with the government building. Will more civil servants be working from home as we move forward?
Good afternoon, everyone. So I'm about to send out a memo to all civil servants setting out exactly what they expect. But yes, the vast majority of services in this building will be shut down. The vast majority of the civil service will be shut down. Our continuity of operations has been working well over the past few weeks. But now, as the Premier said, unless you're absolutely needed, we want you to stay home. So the memo that I'm sending out lists our emergency services. There's many, but there are many services that are not absolutely essential, and we want our civil servants to follow the advice, stay home, protect yourselves and your family.
DJ, tell them about immigration.
So that would mean that our CBC, our Customs and Border Control, our work offices that deal with work permits, they will also be shut down. And we will have a plan in place to ensure that persons who need permission to remain in the island, persons whose work permits are going to be expired, that they will be in good grace with us over the next few weeks. So we're not going to be taking any enforcement action against those persons because we also want them to stay indoors and keep safe.
Thank you, Deputy Governor. Felicia.
Felicia Rankin-Solins, Radio Cayman. So we've heard that it's been discouraged from businesses to use paid vacation and sick leave for their employees during this difficult time. But we've heard that this is still happening with certain businesses, and it's caused quite a bit of uproar amongst the community that think that this is unfair, that this is already being implemented to employees, like in jewelry stores. What is your opinion on this already happening for employees, and it's just at the beginning?
Well, this is very difficult. Some businesses have the wherewithal to continue to pay employees for quite some time. Other businesses that are operating on a shoestring just may not have the capacity to do so. As hard as it is to have this treated as this sort of mandatory mandatory leave from work, that is certainly to be preferred to being terminated. I think everyone, and particularly employers, are going to need to take a sort of longer-term view of this. I think many people are still trying to treat this as though this is going to be some temporary issue. We are going to be in for really difficult economic times, at least until the end of the year, maybe well beyond that. So I think employers need to take a step back and a longer-term view about the continued viability of their businesses and the importance of their employees or particular employees to the success of that business, and to try to treat those employees as good as they possibly can, because they're going to need them to be able to continue in the very difficult times that we have coming. Government may well have to look at sort of special legislation to deal with this going forward, but quite frankly, right now, our principal focus is on suppression of the transmission of the virus. So we have very little resources to devote to those, although they are important human issues. The most important issue right now is to try to keep the country as safe as possible and our people as healthy as possible. If we come through the next couple of weeks with minimal casualties, I treat this as a war, we will be then, I think, much better placed to start looking at some of the economic issues which we're going to have to grapple with in the medium to longer term.
And we've heard you all repeat time and time again the importance of staying home, staying in small groups of people, but we're still hearing that there are people who have plans of Easter camping on island. If you wouldn't mind reiterating to the public the consequences of taking part in these types of activities.
Well, we are now moving to essential and lockdown. Non-essential persons are required to shelter in place. That means stay at home. We are also moving, and I did mention this earlier, to restricting gatherings to two persons unless they are members of your immediate family. So I think those measures might just have some impact on whether you can go to camping at Easter.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. McLaughlin, we had talked last week several times, actually, about the idea of people being able to, dip into their pensions. Has anything more been discussed since last week when we discussed that?
As I've just said to Felicia, focus now is on suppression of the spread of the virus. Every resource that we have to bring to bear on that, that's what we're doing. Those issues are important. Absolutely important, but we got to get through this next 2 weeks. No one is going to starve, no one's going to lose their house, no one's going to have their water turned off, their electricity turned off in the next couple of weeks. We just need to do what is necessary to suppress the transmission of this virus through the community so we come out the end of this two-week period in good shape. And then we can focus on those issues.
Given the announcement today, though, there might be some business owners, especially small business owners, who maybe are worried about some of those things. Again, you might have the same answer for this question, but has there been any more discussion about potentially bailouts, if you want to call it that, from government to small businesses? We heard Minister Hugh last week talk about the availability of soft loans. But beyond that, is there anything else that government has discussed since then about helping out businesses?
Remember my last response.
Okay.
Any further questions?
One time from okay. Me, please. Outside of the curfew hours permit, are there any other restrictions on movement? For example, can people still go out to the beach or take that necessary mental health walk in light of these new changes that we have today?
Right. So those are some of the things that we are would constitute exceptions. Again, we're looking at what's been done and is being done in some other countries. So some of the carve-outs would be for essential travel to the doctor, to the grocery store, to the bank, to the pharmacy, to refuel, for outdoor exercise and that sort of thing. As long as people observe the distancing requirements and as long as you don't do so in a group. So those are some of the things that are going to be contained in the regulations which the Cabinet will make shortly. And then we can announce them.
Thank you.
Okay, if there are no further questions at this time, there is a planned press briefing for later on sometime this afternoon, so we'll get your other questions in at that time. We thank you, of course, for joining us, and we'll see you back here later on.
Clear.